Namaste, angels. I'm here to do the reading for July 22nd. And that is going to be Friday, July 22nd, which is 7119 or 99 or 18, which is 9. 9, of course, in angel numbers, meaning humanitarianism or endings. Means the same in numerology, actually. Humanitarianism or endings. In supreme mathematics, what's today's math? Born. 9 means born. I want to see what the dice have to say. Eat cake. This one actually next. No. So maybe that means don't eat cake. And sex. Let's see what the cards say. Since no is in the middle. Maybe we should eat cake and not have sex. Or maybe it's saying eat cake? No. Have sex instead. We'll see what the cards say. Also, I have a video going up right now called the 411 on 911 or 911. And in that video, I state that starring in the role of the two witnesses, or playing the role of the two witnesses from Revelations or the book of Daniel, I believe the book of Enoch as well, for our purposes of understanding how the prophecy is fulfilled, are Saddam Hussein and Osama bin Laden. That's what I see. Those are the two beings wearing sackcloth who would torment the earth and its inhabitants from all over the world. Who would be mocked and celebrated in their death publicly. Who would respond with fire to their enemies. And I think the Bible said they would be called, and it's sort of like for argument, written in the, I'm paraphrasing, but it's sort of like written in the Bible as, for argument's sake, they'll be called Sodom in Egypt. Yeah, Saddam and bin Laden, like Aladdin of Egypt. How did I get to all of that? Bobby Smurda, GS9, I go so hard. The same way I got to the book of Jeremiah and Archangel Jeremiah through Jeremiah birthday sex. How birthday sex equals, oh, okay, I understand God. Jeremiah 29. Same thing. But now, Source, Spirit, God would like me to add two other meanings for GS9. The first being, well, they're not in any particular order, but the first that I'm going over, G-force. I think I'll start with the human tolerance of G-force. And this is just from Wikipedia. Human tolerances depend on the magnitude of the G-force, the length of time it's applied, the direction it acts, the location of application, and the posture of the body. The human body is flexible and deformable, particularly in the softer tissues. a hard slap on the face may briefly impose hundreds of G locally, but not produce any real damage. A constant 16 G for a minute, however, may be deadly. When vibration is experienced, relatively low peak levels can be severely damaging if they are at the resonance frequency of organs and connective tissues. To some degree, G tolerance can be trainable, and there is also considerable variation in innate ability between individuals. In addition, some illnesses, particularly cardiovascular problems, reduce G tolerance. Now, what does this mean? For one thing, I think this is why spirit is always asking us to exercise and get in shape, because I think with the vibration that is mentioned here, and I can click on the hyperlink for vibration to give a more clear definition as it relates to G-force, you know, from this article. But I think as our in vibrations are being increased, remember G is D. And D is G. And they're both God. Remember, King Osiris's original name begins with D. DJ. He's a DJ. And he's D. But he's also that G force that impacts our vibration. And when a vibration is experienced, relatively low peak G levels can be severely damaging. So I think that's what he means, in part, by the line from the song, Hot Boys, because he is a hot boy too, remember. As a seraph, he would be a fire serpent angel in that vibration of himself, a fire serpent angel. That's a hot boy. So I think he's saying, in part, when I increase your vibration, GS9, I go so hard, and it can be damaging to you if your body is not prepared. And that's why he wants us to prepare for the body changes. And again, listen to your body. If it tells you to go to sleep, go to sleep. If you feel thirsty, don't eat instead. Actually drink some water, preferably the alkaline balanced pH water, if you can get your hands on that. Vibration. Vibration is a mechanical phenomenon whereby oscillations occur about an equilibrium point. The word comes from the Latin vibratonum, shaking, brandishing. The oscillations may be periodic, such as the motion of a pendulum, or random, such as movement of a tire on a gravel road. Vibration can be desirable, for example, the motion of a tuning fork, the reed in a woodwind instrument, or harmonica, a mobile phone, or the cone of a loudspeaker. Now, why did I read that part? Because once I saw that it related to music, I thought that it may have some meaning to King, quote unquote, DJ. God. In many cases, however, vibration is undesirable, wasting energy and creating unwanted sound. For example, the vibrational motions of engines, electric motors, or any mechanical device in operation are typically unwanted. Such vibrations could be caused by imbalances in the rotating parts, uneven friction, or the meshing of gear teeth. Careful designs usually minimize unwanted vibrations. He may want you to know this as well. remember, in a vibration of his, he's also a roughneck, a blue-collar laborer. Right? A hard-working man. He's Paul Bunyan. The studies of sound and vibration are closely related. Sound or pressure waves are generated by vibrating structures. For example, vocal cords. These pressure waves can also induce the vibration of structures. For example, eardrum. Hence, attempts to reduce noise are often related to issues of vibration. This also could be speaking to the increase that the queen, the goddess queen mother Isis, said she would be gifting us as a collective with regard to clairaudience. Your ears, your inner ear, the fluid in our inner ear, which I believe to be sinal fluid, but don't quote me. It's been a while since I officially studied biology. But our ears sort of control our balance and our equilibrium, which is mentioned here in this article. If you get an infection in your inner ear, it's possible you won't be able to stand. You may be saying, how is my ear related to, you know, my legs? But it's like a buoy mechanism, right? Or scales and water. It's all about balance. Again, goes back to balance. That water in our inner ear is not where it belongs. If it's trapped in another part of the ear, which can happen, that can throw off our equilibrium, our balance. All right, let me go back to the GS part. So I sort of started from mid-article because I went into how GS9 or G-force can affect a human being. And of course, the article doesn't stop there. You can, you know, go on Wikipedia and look up G-force. But what is it? I'm going to go to what is it in itself now. G-force is a measurement of the type of acceleration that causes weight. Despite the name, it is incorrect to consider G-force a fundamental force as a quote-unquote G-force, lowercase character. I love how they said in parentheses, lowest case character, because I always say that we are G-force. We are God, lowercase g. Many of you are Jesus, small j. Right? I am Isis, lowercase I. Some of you may be Isis, smaller I than mine. Similar to the Jesuits. Okay, these were Jesus-like people. Seraphs, or seraphim for the plural, actually. But they were not Jesus of Nazareth. There was a Jesus on the cross, or convicted with Jesus, but he was not Jesus of Nazareth. Only one is Jesus of Nazareth. So only one is the original Saint Francis. Only one is the original Isis and the other ascended masters and archangels. So one of you will be the actual reincarnation, but nevertheless, lowercase, you know, whatever their name is. And there may be others like you with an even smaller lowercase, a lower vibration, a lesser G-force. Okay. A G-force, lowercase character, is a type of acceleration that can be measured with an accelerometer. Since G-force accelerations indirectly produce weight, any G-force can be described as a weight per unit of mass. When the G-force acceleration is produced by the surface of one object being pushed by the surface of another object, the reaction force to this push produces an equal and opposite weight for every unit of an object's mass. And this is making sense to me with the law of energy, right? For every action is an equal and opposite reaction. Because it's not called the law of energy. What is it called? It'll come to me. But that is what it is. That is the, I give you the answer, and I have to come up with the question. I have to remember the question. But for every action is an equal and opposite reaction, and that's what this is talking about here. And that is what is demonstrated, symbolized by E equals MC squared as well. The fact that energy can be transferred and moved and will be, never destroyed. That's why everything around us is energy. Everything that exists, inanimate and animate, is energy. In some ways, it's obnoxious, arrogant of us to determine what is inanimate. Just because we don't see it moving doesn't mean that it doesn't do something. Right, take these crystals, for example, the power that's emanated from them. Now, in most people's houses, they don't get up and move. They might in mine. But for the most part, these things don't move, even in my house. However, or they don't move where I can see them, right, walking away or something. However, the energy that is emanated from them is certainly animated. It helps to reanimate me. In some cases, if you're, and you know, and us, if you're feeling down, if you're feeling weakened, these crystals can restore your energy. So perhaps they're not inanimate. Depends how you look at it. Quote unquote, change your perspective, like the hangman. In a straight and level flight, so this is with regard to a plane, lift L equals W, which is weight. In a bank turn of 60 degrees, it equals double the weight, L equals 2W. The pilot experiences 2G and a doubled weight. The steeper the bank, the greater the G-force. Again, if you want to learn more about G-force, I found this on Wikipedia. I'm sure there are many sites that would help you to gain an understanding of G-force. Another meaning for GS9, as shown to me today, or GS9, I go so hard, is, to get back to those blue collar workers, the general schedule of U.S. civil service pay. U.S. civil service pay scale. That means anybody that works for the federal government in any capacity is paid along the, for them in large part, general schedule, the GS, and then would have a rank. The General Schedule GS is the predominant pay scale within the United States Civil Service. The GS includes the majority of white-collar professionals, professional, technical, administrative, and clerical positions. As of September 2004, 71% of federal civilian employees were paid under the GS. The remaining 29%, 11, were paid under the other systems, such as the Federal Wage System, WG, for federal blue-collar or civilian employees. The Senior Executive Service and the Executive Schedule for high-ranking federal employees and other unique pay schedules used by some agencies, such as the United States Securities and Exchange Commission, I wanted to see what I felt from that, because I know overall what the sentiment is with regard to the stock exchange. And what the sentiment is with regard to the stock exchange as it relates to Oppenheimer, for example. And it's not a good one. I'm not quite sure yet what he's saying about this, but it's to point out that this is not something of which he's a fan. Starting in 2009, some federal employees were also paid under pay bands, BANDS. And some history. The GS was enacted into law by the Classification Act of 1949, which replaced a similar act of the same name enacted in 1923. The GS is now, they're both sixes, I believe. 1949 is 14 or 5. Which replaced a similar act of the same name enacted in 1923, which is 6. Oh, that together they make 11. The GS is now codified as part of the Chapter 53 of Title 5 of the United States Code, Sections 5331, 7, which is 12, to 5338, which is 8, 11, or 19. And happens to be 8 and 11, which is justice and abundance together. Saint Germain and Lady Portia, again, in my mind, 8 and 11. The intent of the GS is to keep federal salaries equitable among various and between men and women, equal pay for equal work, which is bullshit in many aspects, you know, but like all the other amendments and acts and everything else that only apply, that don't apply equally, and in some places don't apply to some beings at all. Prior to January 1994, GS personnel, were generally paid the same amount for a given grade and step, regardless of where they worked. The system ignored the growing reality of regional differences in salaries and wages across the United States, and this led to a perception that in many locations, federal civil service salaries were increasingly uncompetitive with those in the private sector, thus affecting recruiting and retention efforts by federal agencies. So they were getting like the shitty workers in certain metropolises, let's say, because they could not compete with private industry. January 1994, the Federal Employees Pay Comparability Act of 1990 introduced a locality pay adjustment competent to the GS salary structure. Both Republican and Democratic administrations have complained about the methodology used to compute locality adjustments and the projected cost of closing the pay gap between federal salaries and those in the private sector. in December 2007, another nine, all these years are nine that they mentioned, reference. The president's pay agent reported that an average locality pay adjustment of $36.89, so 9.8 or 17 or 8, abundance and justice, percent would be required to reach the target set to close the computed pay gap between federal and non-federal pay to a disparity of 5%. By comparison, in calendar year 2007-9, the average locality pay adjustment actually authorized was 16.88. Of course, 16 in itself is 88. So this is 88.88 or 8888. It's a lot of justice and a lot of abundance there. Or 16.16, which would be 7.7. Or 14 or 5 again. As a result, FEPCA, which is the acronym they've given to this Locality Act of Fair Locality Pay Adjustment, has never been fully implemented. Okay, so like I was just saying, so many other laws, acts, rules, never fully implemented, never implemented with regard to certain people, etc., etc. So when you scroll down, they have a base salary with scales GS grade from 1 through 15. And GS9 is somewhere in the middle thereabouts, I guess, representing, quote unquote, the middle class, with the lowest GS9 salary being $42,823 and the highest being $55,000. 666. That was 55666. That's pretty interesting. Then they have a list of different major cities and what the percentage rate for the locality pay adjustment is for those cities. So, for example, to give you some of the larger cities, in Atlanta, the rate is 19.58%, Charlotte 14.44%, San Diego 24.73%, Sacramento 22.61%, Raleigh 17.94%, Philadelphia 22.22%. That's very interesting. New York 29.2% or 11.2% or 13%. So you guys can look all this up. But basically, a GS9 would be your average Joe or Joseph, in our case, more likely. Okay. Now, why do I think we're to talk about average Joes? Well, I was given first one and then two songs to do with this reading for the day, and they both have to do with a person who is not necessarily taken seriously and is taken for granted upon their quote unquote comeuppance, as my mother would say. All of a sudden, everybody's interested in them. Like, let's take an unattractive, let's say, quote-unquote unattractive female or male. But they hit the lotto, all of a sudden they become real pretty, and everybody wants them. Well, when I was a teenager coming up, that was called giving people the vapors. And that terminology came from musician, rapper, Bismarck, or Bismarcky, and he had a song called The Vapors, and that is one of the songs I was told to mention today. Giving somebody the vapors is like when you, like, coming back as a phantom, you know, and giving them just your air, like, you know, not your time. They catch the vapors of you only. You went by so fast, you had such a G-force, that all they caught was the vapor that you left behind. And I'm using the Lover's Path Tarot because, again, this is a reading for Friday. And as I say that, I open to the Lovers, Isis and Osiris. And on the other side, the Prince of Staves, or the Knight of Wands. I'm using these, the Lover's Tarot, because it is both a regular tarot and a more romantic tarot. The Lovers are back, right on the bottom now. I'm going to cut. And since this is the Friday reading, and which goes into the weekend and covers that period as well, I figured let's do some love and some general at once, simultaneously. So I'm also going to use my butterfly cards because that they, I feel, signify the changes and those upgrades to where we can, you know, one day be GS1 and the next GS15 and give people the vapors. Bottom of the deck after I cut is the Four of Coins now, and you see it's different from some Four of Coins in some other decks. I'm trying to see who's on this, because her divine masculine looks sort of like a phantom, like he might be made of some sort of vapor. And she's holding a space for him. Right, a metaphorical space in holding this coin with the heart on it and the angel wings and the crown. Thinking about him. She has the other three coins near. And he's watching. I'm going to ask for cards now. Trying to decide if I could read the cards. Is Illusion upright? Ivan and Odette. Illusion is major arcana card number 18, the moon in the traditional tarot, which is appropriate today that I'm recording this for the 22nd is the 20th. So the morning following the official day of the full moon, night of the full moon, the 19th. Let's see if we can get the vapors while I'm deciding whether or not to read the cards together or separately. Yep. I think I'll read them together. And I'm hearing that for some, he's just a friend applied, and that caused some of the breakups, the karmics, you know, and that can go either way for the masculine or the feminine. I just opened to End of an Era on that note, with the breakups. And be true to you. So I think that's very appropriate in both cases. End of an era is back, or nine, or 9-9, as in the 22nd of July, 2016. 9-9, or nine. The end of an era. End of an era is back on the bottom, and I was just made to notice, get some rest. And then welcome the new. This turned up now twice in the bottom, so I'm going to cut this deck. Giving way for Join In now at the bottom. Remember this song that I went over with Chic, Nile Rodgers, and his group. Don't be a drag. Participate. We're going to enjoy some clams on the half shell and roller skates. Roller skates. Good times. Okay? God wants you to participate actively because you want to, not because you feel forced. And he can tell the difference. He knows the difference. He knows who's real and who's fake. Right, and the fake ones, that's the type of people he hates. So if you're real and you know it, clap your hands. The bottom of the deck is retirement. I'm feeling this may have something to do with I don't want to be a player no more. Like hanging up the old sneakers. I'm picturing sneakers. I don't know why. Maybe this has to do with buy shoes. And actually one of the angelics got commented that she felt like buy shoes meant like, you know, to give somebody their walking papers. And in reading it, I immediately thought of one of my most favorite songs ever, and it's by Nancy Sinatra. These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do. One of these days, these boots are gonna walk all over you. And that song is to, you know, a man that didn't treat her the way she deserved to be treated. Retirement. That's the overall energy of that deck. Okay, the vapors. Radio, TV, and even the press know the meaning of V-A-P-O-R-S. The meaning of this word, without no doubt, means nobody wants to be there when you're down and out. Once you've established and got a lot of money, everybody want to be your buddy and honey. Like tall buildings, they call them skyscrapers. And then he does his little beatbox there. That I won't be, you know, try to really emulate. I did it as a joke just now there. Can you feel it? Nothing can save you, for this is the season of catching the vapors. And since I got time, what I'm gonna do is tell you how it spread throughout my crew. Well, you all know TJ Swan, who sang on my records, Make the Music. Nobody beats the biz. Well, check it. Back in the days before this began, he used to try to talk to this girl named Fran. The type of female with fly Gucci wear, with big truck jewelry and extensions in her hair. When Swan tried to kick it, and I don't know why I said Sean there. So I'm not sure if there's something going on with a Sean out there. to whom this may more directly apply. When Swan tried to kick it, she always fessed, talking about like fess like bullshit it. Talking about, baby, please, you work for UPS, as if that's something about which to be embarrassed, right? Since he wasn't no type of big drug dealer, my man TJ Swan didn't appeal to her. But now he trucks gold and wears fly valley boots, rough leather fashions, and tough silk suits. Now she stopped fronting and wants to speak and be coming to the shows every single weekend. To get his beeper number, she be begging, please, dying for the day to get skis. She caught the vapors. And he says that four times. She caught the vapors, to emphasize it. Now, Bismarck, by the way, really is the type of person that he describes here. Like, as large as he was to us, the teens of the time when he was most popular, he was always down to earth. My last vivid memory of him in my life is I went to his birthday party. It was at a public school in Harlem. I don't remember which school. And he's an established rapper now at this point, in New York City at least. I don't know, you know, how far his fame extended. But to us, he was, you know, one of those very large beings, you know, a larger than life being. This is Bismarck. His birthday party was at this public school. I was on my way to the birthday party with the young lady that my mother was going to become a foster mother to. And I got this nosebleed, as I used to do rather often as a small child, that had kind of stopped and tapered off, but then every now and then I'd get a random nosebleed. So I went into this bodega and I asked for a copper penny. I was going to put it on my head. And these Dominican men, not even females, men, about five of them, came like rushing from different parts of the store, like the back and everything, and they took me into the back with them and like sat me in a chair with my head back and put the penny and did some other stuff. I don't recall exactly all of what, but the nosebleed went away. I felt better. I went on to the party, hung out with Biz at his party, me and the other young lady, because I wasn't anybody quote unquote famous, but my way has always been similar, as my friends as well, just down to earth. People are people. And so, you know, we were always able to talk to these quote unquote celebrities, you know, and treat them like human beings, and vice versa. They were able to treat us like human beings, not as something less than because we were not celebrities. And I guess people that were other than that are to whom he gave the vapors. Okay, so the next verse is, I got another partner that's calm and plain. He goes by the name of the Big Daddy Kane. And I've already described in previous videos the Big Daddy Kane was the same way. And that I used to hang out with him often too. At most often at Club Negril on 42nd Street, 7th Avenue. Yeah. He goes by the name of the Big Daddy Kane. A mellow type of fellow that's laid back. Very true. Back in the days, he wasn't nothing like that. I remember when he used to fight every day. What grown-ups would tell him, he would never obey. He wore his pants hanging down and his sneakers untied and a Rasta-type Kango tilted to the side. Around his neighborhood, people treated him bad and said he was the worst thing his mom's ever had. They said he would grow up to be nothing but a hoodlum, or either in jail or someone would shoot him. But now he's grown up, and to their surprise, Big Daddy got a hit record selling worldwide. Now the same people that didn't like him as a child be saying, can I borrow a dollar? Ooh, you're a star now. They caught the vapors. And he says that four times again. Now I got a cousin by the name of Von Lee. So here goes this Lee again. Better known to y'all as Cutmaster Cool V. V as in victory, as in Roman numeral 5. He cuts, scratches, transforms with finesse. And then they do a cutting sound there and all that mess. Well, I remember when he first started to rock and tried to get a job in a record shop. He was in it to win it, but the boss fronted, says, "Sorry, Mr. Lee, but there's no help wanted." Now my cousin Vaughn still tried on and on and on till the break of dawn to put this J-O-B in effect, but they'd look right past him and be like, "Next." Now for the year of 88. So 88 is back. We just looked at it in the GS9 description article. Meaning on Wikipedia, and now here it's back. This was the year 88. Cool B is making dollars, so my cousin's like, straight. He walks into the same record shop as before, and the boss be like, "Vaughn, welcome to my store," offering him a job. But nah, he don't want it. Damn, it feels good to see people up on it, because I remember when at first they wasn't. Now guess what they caught from my cousin? The vapors. They caught the vapors. And of course, he says that four times again. Last subject of the story is about Bismarck. I had to work for mine to put your body in park. When I was a teenager, I wanted to be down with a lot of MC, DJ, and crews in town. So in school on Noble Street, I say, "Can I be down, champ?" They say no and treated me like a wet food stamp. After getting, because food stamps used to not be on an EBT card. They used to be physical pieces of paper in these books you had to rip out. So if one got wet, of course it was a wet piece of paper and fairly useless, potentially at least. So he was treated like a wet food stamp. After getting rejected, I was very depressed. Sat and wrote some deaf doo-doo rhymes at my rest. When I used to come to parties, they'd make me pay. So like I told you, I used to go out several days per week and not pay to get into the clubs. Certain people, whether you're in the music industry or a dancer or just somebody that with that kind of popularity, they can help to get the crowd moving, going, or to show up, they don't charge you, or at least they didn't. I guess it's like VIP, technically today. So when I used to come to parties, they'd make me pay. I'd have to beg to get on the mic and rap that day. I was never into girls. I was just into my music. They acted like I wanted to keep it instead of trying to use it. His penis, of course, he means there. But now things switched without belief. "Yo, Biz, do you remember me from Noble Street, Chief? We used to be down back in the days. It happens all the time. They never cease to amaze. They caught the vapors." He's talking about those people that didn't really want to hang out with him, trying to get him to recall a time when they were friends that never existed. And he says that four times, and that's how the song ends. The other song is slightly similar, along the same, in the same vein, kind of. Wait. I'm getting it. And this one is kind of the same era. This is called the Gas Face by a group called Third Base, which was three guys, two rappers and a DJ. Two rappers were two so-called white boys. The quote-unquote lead, I guess, being MC Search, who I've spoken of before. Like I said, he was at the Latin Quarter the night that BDP performed and threw out the singles. He performed Play That Funky Music, White Boy. And he didn't get kicked out or beaten up. So that was a good thing. He survived. Okay. The Gas Face. "Hey, yo, man, my label mate, Don Newkirk. Man, step to him. Thanks, Search." And it's Search, S-E-R-C-H, no A. "And now for the Prime Minister, P. Pete Nice. The guy's name was Pete Nice, but they have it all broken out here. Nice, nice, nice. Kick him in the grill, Pete. So of course, the grill is the face. Gas, past tense, made facially. So he's saying it's the word gas, but he's using it as a verb in the past tense through, it's a facial expression. Gas, past tense, made facially. Third base will express KMD. Three blind mice on site. Zeb Blubber gave it the first light. A grin shows a trick up a sleeve. Ha! What a tangled web they weave. Deceivers, stupefied through fable. Say, let's make a deal at the dinner table. Put you on tour. Put your record on wax. Trust me. Sign your life on the X. You exit. And then he has the capital X again. X off. But what you really get, a box of Newports and Puma sweats. Damn. So he's talking about bad contracts. I guess in his case that a musician might have entered during the time. Somebody get you to sign your life away and sign your talent away and you really get nothing for it. But you got some name brand sweatpants now. Puma sweats and Newport cigarettes to smoke. Text feeds and frowns upon Emus. To give up gas face, he drinks from a thermos. Sub Rock will cut you with a clipper. Gas face given, I beg to differ. So he's saying like gas face is like when you screw up your face, as a West Indian would say, a screw face. That's what a gas face is. So he's using it at that time. He says, like, gas face given. I'm screwing up my face right now because I beg to differ. I think you're full of shit. Pete, that was real deaf, man, but I gotta get serious now. Ayo, Don, step to him again. Everybody, MC Search, like he's introducing him. Black cat is bad luck. Bad guys wear black. Must have been a white guy who started all that. Make the gas face for those little white lies. My expression to the mountainous blue eyes. Then form a face and shape my skull cap. Dismiss the myth that evil is not black, but opposite spectrum. This done by red man with horns on his head. Laid down the ill plan. Got all his helpers. Said make it snappy. Tell all the people that their hair can't be nappy. Blonde and blue-eyed, or dark-skinned, half a G, capital G he has there. A disease created by leprosy. Don't speak of bleach. Bend them to right. Say it was night way before the light. Put aside spooks. Search leaves a trace. I've set them correct with the effect of the gas face. So he's saying the devil came in and fed the people a bunch of bullshit about how like white is good and better, and he's setting things straight. And this is, again, is a so-called white boy himself who is doing this. So in case my explaining confused any of it, I'll go over that part again, because that may be on what we were to focus, being that's the part about the devil. That may be why I was given this song by spirit. So I'll do it again. Black cat is bad luck. Bad guys wear black. It must have been a white guy who started all that. Make the gas face for those little white lies. My expression to the mountainous blue eyes. Then form a face and shake my skull cap. So he's shaking his head. Dismiss the myth that evil is not black, but opposite spectrum. This done by red man with horns on his head. So not red, quote unquote, red man as in Native Americans, which is a whole other thing we'll probably get into one day, but the one with the horns on his head, he laid down the ill plan and got all his helpers, his minions, and said, make it snappy, okay, post haste, get this done for me. Tell all the people that their hair can't be nappy, that, you know, that's a negative thing. Blonde and blue-eyed, or dark-skinned half a G, a disease created by leprosy. Like, you need to be blonde and blue-eyed if you're dark-skinned, you're less than, you're half a G. And tell them that's a result of a disease. That's a punishment. That's why you're dark-skinned. Blonde and blue-eyed is where it's at. Don't speak of bleach. Bend them to right. Force them to this. say it was night way, that part's in capital letters, before the light. So like night is better, dark is better. Put aside spooks. So now this is MC Search talking. He's putting aside the spooks. Search leaves a trace, kind of like the vapors. I've set them correct with the effect of the gas face. Next up, Don. A special appearance by KMD's Zev Love. Excess. A gas face can either be a smile or a smirk. When appears a monkey wrench to work one's clockwork. Perking his brim to the rim of my cup. Don't tempt me, you're empty, so fill her up. Is I'm taking coffee or cocoa. Is you loco? Cash or credit for unleaded at Sunoco. KMD and third base is just ace in the hole. I mean soul, S-O-U-L. So make the gas face, ha. Damn, if looks could kill. You look like host was a ghost from your grill. But still, what's the new fed to recollect? To our passing phase, to facades, to Eddie Decker. For my label reads hood. Street might have a tattoo. Don't pick any card or no rabbit from my hat. Never a magician if I ever tricked him. Oh shit, another gas face victim. There it is, fellas. Why don't you step to the mic, man? That's how I kicks it for 80. He has D-E-C-A, Decca. Not sure what that meant. I guess a short way of saying the 80s decade. Hey, yo, good looking out, Don, man. Peace. Pungy, yo, who gets the gas face? And then they list a bunch of people that I guess are their friends, and they're joking. Little Vic for the gas face. Tony Dick gets the gas face. No gas faces for plugs 1, 2, and 3. Those are the members of 3 Feet High and Rising. Jeez, here goes my memory again. Their label is 3 Feet High and Rising, though. It is a group of 3 people. De La Soul. Okay. I had to talk myself through that one. No gas face for Professor Prince Paul. My friend Tina gets a big gas face. No gas face for DJ Sub Rock. No gas face for KMD. Hammer, shut the fuck up. Gas face. They were talking about MC Hammer there. At that time, you know, there were rappers of this type, more street soul, and then there were rappers like Hammer that came through, and many of us didn't understand like what that was about. I actually ended up getting into Hammer though, and heard one of his songs in my head the other day, having to do, I guess, with this whole Hammer thing and the letter T and the mallet and God. Push up on the hammer and you will be rewarded. My beat is ever booming and you know I get it started. That came through my head the other day. Anyway, he goes on to talk about his friends, who does and does not get the gas face from him. All right, so that's the theme that I guess through our rebirth, again today is born in Supreme Math, and we understand already that we have been going through a rebirth. Maybe our GS scale is increasing here now. The Queen Goddess has already told us she's giving promotions out. She mentioned specifically the other day, clairaudience. I think in a reading yesterday, the day before, clairvoyance was also mentioned specifically. So all of that may be involved here and why we needed to learn about giving the gas face to people that are full of shit and, you know, to whom we need to be, with whom we need to be done, and giving the vapors to people who took us for granted. Didn't take us seriously, tried to use us for what we had, even if they considered us to not have much, they still wanted that, and as we got more, now they like us, like, you know, quote-unquote, for real, and these are the fakers, these are the phonies. These are the people that we can see right through, and that goes back to what I was describing before. You know, God knows who's real, who's fake. You can tell me anything, tell yourself anything, but if you know in your heart it's not true, so does he. Okay. Masculine. Six of Cups in reverse and courage. So going with the traditional tarot meaning, because I know I went over a different meaning with this particular deck. I see a past life relationship coming, and spirit is telling you to have courage in stepping into that portion of your new beginning. Remember, the overall energies are illusion or the moon, major arcana card, the moon, and retirement. So hanging up, you know, the old jersey. Before it was sneakers, now I'm with the shirt. I'm not sure what these sports references are about. Maybe they, again, mean something particular to a very specific person or persons. Surrounding the masculine is awakening or the hanged man, I believe. Oh, wait, no, the number doesn't coincide with the hanged man, does it? No, it does not. This is XIX, that would be 19, which is the sun. Okay, because in the angel tarot, awakening is the name of the hangman card. So that's why that flew out of my mouth. But now looking at the number, no, this is indeed card number 19, the sun. And that goes perfectly with end of an era. Okay, because this is over. We're letting the sun shine in now for our new beginning. Whatever was involved with that era, we're letting that go. Maybe some of that moon energy was with it, that darkness. We needed to have light shed upon it. And here it is. Let the sun shine in. Okay, we're walking into the age of Aquarius now. Let the sun shine in. And in the book, just to reconfirm that is indeed the sun. Card number 19, XIX, awakening, traditional card, the sun, lovers, Cupid, and Psyche. Keywords, creativity, success, fertility, optimism. Venus was jealous of Psyche's outstanding beauty. She instructed her son Cupid to pierce Psyche with his arrow so she would foolishly love the first creature she saw. But Cupid loved Psyche. He rescued her and secretly took her as his bride. Psyche burned Cupid by accident when she tried to see him by lamplight, and the angered god flew away. Venus put forth many trials to Psyche when she pleaded for her forgiveness. Cupid and Psyche were soon rejoined, awakened to the preciousness of their love by its testing. And this reminds me of the Justin Bieber song, which I heard often and always took to mean something else. And this reminds me of the way that I took it, of how I took it to mean. In the song, he says, my mother don't like you and she likes everyone, right? My mama don't like you and she likes everyone. Saying that this is why he should have known that this woman with whom he was dealing was no good. So I always felt, and this, again, aligned with that feeling, that the mother was wrong. That I was being told that the mother didn't know what she was talking about. And that the fact that she didn't like the woman didn't mean anything because she was incorrect. So that goes along with this, with Venus being jealous. Even that word, jealous is disturbing here. Jealous of her son's woman, the woman her son was in love with. What's going on there with mom? Right? So she didn't like Psyche, but Cupid did. Not only did he like her, he loved her. So they, in the end, Psyche passed these tests that the mother kept setting before her, in order to keep her from her son, and they rejoined. I mean, this is totally describing a twin flame union and a potential experience for some of you. Maybe that's why you had not joined sooner, because the family, the mother or anybody else didn't like you. Doesn't like your partner. Okay, let go of that. let go of that. First of all, they could be under some sort of influence, right? It might not even be them who really feels that way. Their true feelings, ideas, thoughts, memories could be stifled by some sort of dark energy too. Perhaps they need crystals. Perhaps they're just not awakened enough, so they don't get it. But the dark uses, you know, our positive influences against us as well. That's why when I pray, for example, I pray that anybody positive or negative that is being used, that the dark energy be cleared from them and not enabled to latch on to another positive energy in order to approach me. All of that is part of my prayer. And for all, not just me, all of us, because I say, you know, in all light beings, I always include that quote, and all light beings, myself, you know, my twin, and all light beings and their unions, not just ours. Okay, getting back to this. So that was the story of Psyche and Cupid, and that's the energy surrounding the masculine. Here is the sun with the end of an era. That's how I ended up going into all of that. Okay, and in his subconscious balance, Venus again. Venus is back with Vulcan, her twin flame, it looks like. And coupled with that is adult children. So maybe it's not the mama, but the adult children that don't like you. And they need to get over it, or you need to get past that and not be concerned with what they feel. Maybe we are hesitant to join a partner that has adult children for fear of what they'll think of us. We need to let go of that. In either case, it's you and the person and God. No one else. This is the mother of all prearranged marriages, right? This is with whom the universe has instructed you, selected you to be. Do it. But again, it should be done freely and naturally. It shouldn't feel forced. It shouldn't feel like something you don't want to do. Because if that is the case, if that's how it feels, it means your soul has chosen something else. And you should follow it. Because at the number one, at the core, what God really wants for us is freedom, whatever that means. If it means you go a different direction, you go a different way, he wants that for you too. And, you know, that'll be dealt with accordingly. Okay. Feminine. The Six of Wands, or the Victory card in reverse. So this is a victory that's coming, it's somewhat delayed. And it's opposite his Six of Cups that was in reverse. Very interesting. Courage, a purple card that says courage, is atop that Six of Cups in reverse for the masculine. And a purple card that says welcome the new. This card that was here before while I was shuffling that kept showing up. It's back. And it's atop our Victory card, our Six of Wands in reverse. So it's telling us, yes, we will conquer and have a victory and start over, and we are to welcome the new. The Four of Arrows in reverse, indicating that we've done some soul searching, some, and gotten some rest, been through some recovery, restored our energy. And that's going with be true to you. Because often when we do that, we're able to think. We're able to talk to spirit. We get in that prayer pose, laid back in the bed. And we're able to just rest and be clear. And come out in a decisive manner. Say, yes, I'm going to be true to myself now. So this is another card that's back. We were shown this card over and over again, I guess, in general, for both. And now it's specific to the feminine, or to that part of us. Be true to you. Ten of Arrows in reverse. I like. And what does this go with? Healing from the past. I don't think I've ever seen this card. How beautiful is that? So these difficult times and betrayal, all of that stuff that came with the Ten of Swords, that is over. We are overcoming this. It is in reverse. It is a 10. We're done with that. And the result is healing from the past. Very nice. Crowning the Nine of Cups upright. So this is in between the Six of Cups in reverse and the Six of Wands in reverse. Both very positive cards, even in reverse. And in the center of them is the Nine. So this would have been 666 if this was reversed, right? If a nine upside down. Instead, it's 696. And this is the wish card. This is wishes granted, wishes fulfilled. And it's coupled with sentimental feelings. Awesome. So this is emotional fulfillment completely. In our subconscious, at our feet, shared. Brumhilda, the Princess of Staves, another like Knight of Wands, the knight in shining armor taking off. And that's coupled with self-care. So maybe in healing from the past and doing what's right for you, that is self-care. And that would make sense. It's here diagonal to be true to you, which is atop the Four of Swords, or the Four of Arrows in this deck, with the healing, self-care. Be true to you, knight in shining armor. Go that way toward your partner. Don't worry about the adult children that are next to it. Heal from the past. Be true to you. Welcome the new. End of an era. Self-care. Get your courage back. End of an era. Step into the new. Welcome the new. And it's surrounded by nothing but emotional fulfillment and sentimental feelings. So we should have no fear in taking on this courage and walking into good feelings, good vibrations. In the center from Archangel Michael, Zero, Innocence, Tamino, and Pamina. This would be the Fool card, Zero. I'll read what it says. And that's coupled with sobriety. So we're completely clear-minded here. And in that clear, conscious state, deciding to what? Take a leap of faith for love and spirituality. How very awesome is that? But I want to read you from the book what this version of the Fool card means before I go. Because they all come with these little stories. Zero, Innocence. Traditional card, the Fool. Lovers, Tamino and Pamina. Keywords, new ventures. Welcome the new. Innocence, trust, optimism. We had a card that meant optimism. The sun. Wherever the sun is. The magic flute was the last opera Mozart composed before his death in 1791. 8, 9, plus 9, 18, 9. Okay, this is no mistake. Again, today is 9, or the day for which this reading is 9. The year I just read is 9, 1791. Some of its fairy tale plot was inspired by the rites of the Freemasons, a secret society into which Mozart had been initiated. The magic flute tells of a princess named Pamina and a prince named Tamino who learned to trust their hearts, innocent and inexperienced as they may be. Meanings, the start of a great journey. Innocence that allows one to be open to possibilities and protects from difficulties. Facing fears, trusting your heart, feeling protected by the divine. Wow, and the rest of it is for the reversed. Ours was not reversed. Ours is upright. this couple standing behind two pillars, which always represents an 11 to me, and the call to light work and the twin flame journey. They're taking a leap of faith. They're going to be true to who they are. It's self-care. They have these sentimental feelings. It's an end of an era of what didn't work and what was negative. They've healed from the past. We're welcoming the new, full of courage and support from the divine. Time to hang up your old jersey. I hope that you guys enjoyed the day's reading. Namaste, angels.